it over now to our board chair, Carlos Sanchez. He lives in Michigan now, but he is de Mexico. And he's going to introduce our first speaker, Juan Escalante. Bienvenidos, Carlos, y buenos días.
Buenos días, Juana. Buenos días a todos. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. And thank you for joining us for another day of this Lideramos symposium. Yes, we were supposed to be in San Antonio, and right now, as I'm looking outside, it's beautiful here in Michigan. It's sunny, but definitely not at the river in San Antonio. So nonetheless, I hope to be there next year. Without further ado, I'm going to introduce Juan Escalante. We are extremely lucky to have him here. He holds a master's in public administration from Florida State University. I believe he is son of Venezuelan immigrants. Hopefully he will have a chance to tell us a little bit about some arepas later on. He also is an advocate for civil and immigrant rights here in the U.S. Currently, he is the digital strategist at fwd.us, which is a great organization. I encourage you to visit. And also, as Juan was saying, it's important to elevate the work that we've done. And in his case, his work has been highlighted and published in the New York Times, in the USA Today, Univision, CNN, etc. So as you will see, we are very lucky to have him here. So I'm not going to take any more time of his presentation. So folks, please help me welcome Mr. Escalante, Juan Escalante, to give his presentation. Thank you very much.
Un aplauso.
Thank you so much, and thank you, Juana and Carlos, for the invitation, but also for the warm welcome. It means a lot. I'm joining everybody from Washington, D.C., where the sun is not out. It's been kind of cloudy the past couple of days, and you'll have to excuse me. I'm actually, you know, working from home, as many of you may or may not be. But if I do have to transition rather quickly, it's namely because my partner and I share a very small apartment. So I wanted to first get, let me just kind of get up my presentation together. But just before that, while I wrestle here with the technical, I wanted to just kind of illustrate a little bit about what my presentation will be. As I mentioned, as Carlos mentioned, I am the son of Venezuelan immigrants, and at the same time, I'm also an immigrant myself. I was born and raised in Caracas, Venezuela, and my family and I came into the United States when at the top of in the mid 2000s, and since then, it has been a very long journey to kind of figure out the immigration system that continues to power this world. Specifically this country, namely because even though that we have lived here for now 20 years this year, we remain undocumented. That means that without access to, certain key paperwork, my parents and I are essentially still exposed to the threat of deportation, which essentially makes us quite vulnerable, especially given the amount of polarization and the amount of, politics that continue to essentially target Latinos and the Latinx community all across the country. For some reason, and Juana, you'll have to excuse me, my Zoom says that I have to reset the system in order to share my screen. I'm just telling you, it was on my screen. So give me just 1 second. I'll be right back on.
Okay. So just take this moment to take a couple of deep breaths and to kind of relax. You know, Latinos are kinetic learners. We learn by doing, and we like to engage the heart, the body, the mind, and the spirit. And so just roll your shoulders back a little bit. Take a couple of deep breaths. Pull your hands down so you're standing up straight. Breathe and prepare for learning. Today's a kind of a wonderful day because it's Friday, and you know, with COVID, all the days just kind of melt together. But I hope you'll take a little time this weekend to, you know, to re-energize, to be with your family, and to kind of get through these tough times together. So it's really wonderful to have people from so many places. You know, Carlos is from Michigan, Juan from DC, Patricia is from Arizona, the Black and Brown Coalition is from Chicago. So even though these are tough times, wow, have they really brought us together and really shown us that regardless of time and space and place, that we can have this spiritual and this energetic connection, particularly because of our culture and because of our dedication to uplifting our people. Juan, you ready?
Seems that way. Let me go ahead and get my screen up and we can go ahead and get started. All right. Folks can see my screen. Let me just make sure that I kick over and make this in presentation mode. Okay. Well, thank you so much again. I wanted to kind of base a bulk of this presentation on kind of like best practices and what exactly led me to this work. Oftentimes people ask me, you know, how is it that you have this public profile and how is that someone that, you know, does have a legal status got to the place that where you're at? And the truth of the matter is that a lot of it was circumstantial, but mainly driven by the power of the internet. I say that mainly because the power of the internet is what essentially allowed me and a couple other young people at the time to rather have the tools, access, and resources to communicate with one another and kind of develop not just trust over the web at a time where, you know, the internet was not as developed as it is today. And it also allowed us tools that have since evolved into what we call digital strategy, or oftentimes, you know, how to properly use the web to connect people, but also drive forward change in policies. And of course, there we go. So who am I? My name is Juan Escalante. I'm a two-time graduate from Florida State University. I am the oldest of three children. I have two younger brothers. They're also undocumented and they reside in Florida. As I mentioned at the top, I'm currently based out of Washington, D.C. I'm a first generation student. I'm also a digital strategist. I am a huge, huge proponent of pineapple on pizza. For those of you who are making faces, I'm sorry, that's just the way that it is. And I'm also an avid coffee drinker, which is basically what powers most of my days. I'm also a beneficiary of the DACA program. And I'm gonna run through some of these slides rather quickly because I really don't wanna like jolt down a lot of the presentation just basically on myself, but rather I wanna make sure that y'all also kind of understand, you know, what got me to this point and how you can essentially take some lessons away from, you know, what we built, how we built it, and hopefully try to adapt them into the into your own specific work, whether that's, you know, at the various levels of government, or it may just be something as simple as trying to bring change or organize your community at the very local level. So as I mentioned at the very top, I am shielded from deportation at the current time under the DACA program. That's Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals. And what this program does is that it allows me a number of things. It basically mentions, that I am still undocumented, namely because the nature of the program is temporary. And while some people may disagree that I have, you know, some prolonged benefits than other people who have none, the truth of the matter is that we find that this program is it continues to be engulfed in federal litigation efforts and attacks from the federal government and current administration in order to terminate it. Last summer, this past July, we saw the Supreme Court of the United States rule in the favor of the DACA program and basically order that the administration return the program to its original stance, meaning that new people could apply for the program, that the protections will be, you know, codified for the time being. And, you know, what the administration has done since is that they basically, you know, sent out a memorandum saying that they acknowledged what the Supreme Court had said, but they were going to mold the program through a bunch of legal maneuvers and further shortcut it, meaning that now the protections that I enjoy are no longer 2 years length. Now they're 1 year's length. And given the importance of the election that is coming up, the choice couldn't be clearer between, you know, what exactly it means for, you know, almost a million people that are covered on this program and myself. That being said, this program also allows me to drive work, and it allows me to, travel and do the work that I do. I do work as a national advocate for immigrants' rights and immigration policy. Thinking about New York and Colorado, we had two major wins in those states last year as part of the organization that I work at. Forward US invested time, money, and energy into ensuring that driver's licenses for undocumented people will become a reality in New York state, and that is now law. And in Colorado, we were fortunate enough to pass a measure that expanded access to driver's licenses for undocumented people, which essentially means that the state government will now fund access to these driver's licenses into more local DMVs across the state. Again, this is pretty rudimentary for, you know, whenever I speak, but I wanted to make sure that folks understand the scope of what I'm speaking about when I talk about my work. I mentioned that there are almost a million people, and you can see some of the breakdowns in these numbers. I'm happy to send these around so that, you know, we can talk about the nitty-gritty, which is the technical aspect here. But what you have to, you know, basically take away from this particular slide is essentially the sizable contribution, right? And we continue to talk about that. And I just want to mention, you know, who are we as a community? What do we give back to this country? And, you know, how is it that we're recognized as a population? I mentioned that the DACA program that currently, you know, is shielding me from deportation, it's under attack. And this is essentially some of the figures at the very bottom that you can see in terms of dollars that the United States government risks to lose if they actually do away with the program. But, you know, because our community is more than numbers and more than figures, it also, you know, stands to lose a very talented and eager segment of the population that wants to continue to strive for greater heights, but also in the realm of education. DACA recipients are paramedics, doctors, lawyers, are digital strategists as myself. We continue to essentially make waves all across the country. Okay, I'm gonna skip over the questions part. This is a much shorter presentation given the time here that we have. Unless Juana, I see that your microphone's off. Do you have any questions so far?
Yes, I wanted to know what a digital strategist was.
We're getting there. I'm accelerating some of these points to make sure.
This is important for all of us, Juan. Our heart is with DACA.
Absolutely. Thank you. And, you know, I front loaded the DACA point to kind of help illustrate to some folks essentially like the magnitude of the work that we're carrying, right? Over the past number of years, we've seen attacks on refugees, political asylees, DACA recipients, also known as Dreamers, immigrant communities all across the country. And, you know, while I can sit here and just essentially elaborate, you know, how big of an impact that is, you know, the truth of the matter is that I am one of those pieces of the population, and the one that resonates, but that I'm most familiar with is the one that I belong to. So I try to frame that in senses that are familiar to myself, but that also can be a little bit more digestible. So we're talking about almost 700,000 people plus when we talk about DACA. So before we go into things, I also wanted to kind of get a sense of like where we are at in terms of the internet. If you look at this slide, it talks about my life and essentially, you know, the time that we're in, but you know, when we take away, you know, the copy at the very bottom of the slide, we look at these three words: polarization, impacts, and definitions. The internet right now is just like many things, you know, undergoing some very unprecedented times. Given that and even before the pandemic, it was already, you know, shifting course and molding into something new. My job as a strategist is to essentially always have a feel and sense as to how the internet is behaving and what exactly resonates out there. I know that sounds kind of broad and very general, but the truth of the matter is that I'm a creature of habit, and my job is to basically scour the internet for information, people, connections, opportunities that essentially will allow me and the organizations that I work with to clearly give more exposure to our issue. Oftentimes that may be as simple as being in a panel like this one, which is pretty direct. We're speaking to a predominantly Latinx community. Other times is, and I kid you not, an opportunity to speak at a Comic-Con type of panel to a completely different audience that may not care about immigration, but they must, the opportunity is there, and I have to figure out a way to connect those pieces together in order to make sure that our message is delivered and that someone hopefully out there within that crowd that's looking at it is able to do it. So in the beginning, let me go back before I go to the timeline. Right now, the internet is undergoing significant polarization. If you are using WhatsApp, if you're using Facebook, you can see some of the most clear examples of misinformation that is being driven to our people by bad agents. And I say bad agents, not just, you know, people who may have difference of opinions, the ones that you may hold. I mean people who are out there to clearly pump and fill spaces in the internet with things that are just flat out false, demonstrably false. You know, we're talking about memes, we're talking about forward chains, we're talking about articles that are written without any sort of secondary verification or proof. That's kind of like where the state of the world is right now, but it's reflected also in some way, shape, or form across our digital platforms and how we choose to engage online. Impact has also been, sizably shifted. It used to be that you would develop, a very comprehensive digital program that included text messaging, email, a social media campaign, so on and so forth, and you were able to measure some of those things. But the pandemic has kind of turned that over in its head, and we're still kind of recoiling and learning what exactly that means. More people are at home. They're consuming, media at a much more accelerated amount. That includes digital content. So for those of you who have, who are, asking your friends or family for the new Netflix recommendation, you're part of this. You are essentially, consuming things much faster because you may be working from home, or you may find yourself, with more spare time, given that, we're not, due to the health concern, we're not leaving our homes as often as we used to. And the definition of things is also extremely viable in here. I was just watching a documentary last night with our partner here, and we were talking that, essentially highlighting how, there's essentially a movement to try to, kind of redefine the way in which in which policies should be viewed, in which science should be interpreted, in which, various aspects of our traditional life or our society, can be seen. And those two and those definitions continue to, essentially suffer at the hands of the polarization and the impact that the internet continues to have on our daily routines and our daily lives. I included this timeline to kind of, illustrate both, the immigration aspect, but also the digital aspect. If you see here, right, we go from, I covered kind of a straight decade in here. For those of you who may remember 2007, I know I do, it was essentially a very outdated kind of sense of the way. And I know that this sounds kind of ridiculous given that it was only like 13 years ago. But if you think back at the phone that you had in your pocket, what exactly was that? It was definitely not the latest iPhone with the latest camera model on the, you know, a 4G web connection. It probably looked like a Nokia or, you know, the very, I remember that I used to have a BlackBerry, you know, for those of you who had those and enjoyed the messaging features between that. Around that time, I was essentially graduating from high school myself, and I just didn't quite know what I was going to do. Given the limitations of my status, I figured out that the internet was the only mesh, like the only recourse in which I could essentially engage other people that were undergoing similar experiences, right? Other dreamers who were also undocumented tried to navigate higher education systems. And, you know, I started trying to get my foothold in there. I must confess, you know, growing up, I think for some of you who, you know, maybe contemporary with me or maybe parents, you may have heard at one point or another, you know, like, mijo, can't go online and believe everything and everyone that, you know, that's out there. You know, there's some bad people on the internet. And the same thing kind of applied, right, to my personal life, not just because of the way that I was trying to use the internet and talking to, quite frankly, strangers who also claimed to be undocumented, but also because of this cardinal rule that undocumented families are often pushed to live by, which is basically like, you can't tell anybody about your status. You just can't, right? Like, can't tell your neighbor, you can't tell your friend at school, because if you do, like, you put us at risk, and, you know, you don't know where that information is going to end up at. And for me, that was kind of like the barrier to access, right? Like, I knew that, you know, instinctively, that was essentially holding me and a lot of people back. Namely because if we couldn't use, you know, our immigration status as a tool for change, then we weren't going to be using it as a storytelling component, and much less as kind of, I don't want to say a shield, but rather, probably like on the same lines of a tool for change. It used to be, and it continues to be, so that, you know, the media, politicians, and certain actors in the far right continue to demonize immigrants by, you know, summoning their status and their lack of immigration status or papers as a way to paint them as others, as inferior. And for me, it was very important to switch that model upside down and just kind of leave with the fact, like, yeah, I am undocumented, so what? At the time, again, the era of the BlackBerry is a very revolutionary time, and it was a very revolutionary act, namely because nobody really knew what the impact would be, right? President Barack Obama was elected in 2008, and between 2008 and 2010, you know, we were still kind of in that era where Facebook was kind of like a thing, Twitter was this weird thing that people had no idea, you know, whether or not it was going to stick around. You know, a lot of people did not know how to use it. For those of you who were early adopters like myself, it had like a text messaging, SMS, short code component. And just, it was like this weird thing that a lot of people were kind of like, I know I should be in here, but I'm not really sure. And between those 2 years, it was my job to basically use these tools, right, to reach as many people as possible. I say that namely because it wasn't just about like posting on Facebook frivolously, you know, and just blasting out and blanket covering everybody's feeds with messages about immigration, but we had to be strategic, right? When we think about, you know, the great causes that we get into or that, you know, we try to represent, we oftentimes think about, you know, what is our theory of change? What is the narrative? And all these elements really didn't have simple answers, right? Because up until this point, you know, immigrants, you know, and especially undocumented immigrants were treated as these people who were extremely vulnerable and could not speak up for themselves because of fear of retaliation. And a group of quite literal kids, you know, in the 18, 19s, you know, were essentially, you know, trying to push that narrative, you know, out and usher a new one, which is why you see so many people out and about now sharing their stories. You know, if you've ever heard the phrase undocumented and unafraid, you know, that was a very early, phrase that we used, you know, in order to essentially encourage other people to do two things. One, share their story publicly or privately. Two, build community. And three, you know, be honest with themselves, because what we discovered was that we were more vulnerable in silence than if we were out and about displaying, you know, our status and wearing it like a badge of honor. The reason being was because if no one knows you're undocumented and you get that knock at the door or you get, you know, pulled over on the side of the road, no one has your information. You know, it takes us longer to do a rapid response campaign. And it would just be easier if we knew who you were, where you, you know, where you resided in common terms, if we had any points of information or family members that we can, you know, ask for help at a time of crisis. And, you know, I'm happy to report that after a number of years, you know, that mentality and that narrative broke through. And the internet, you know, through social media platforms, but also email, SMS, and, you know, spaces like these, which are becoming more, it's kind of, for me, dystopian at this point in time, because I remember using Zoom before Zoom was a thing. And for me, you know, now everybody knows what Zoom is, and everybody's, you know, either buying a membership or hosting a webinar or having family meetings and stuff like that. But my job, and again, to elaborate on Juana's point, is to essentially always find these kind of opportunities, softwares, or avenues in which I can plug in and quickly redirect conversations without, you know, having the naysayers, our opponents, conspiracy theorists, you know, kind of have a free pass at the internet. In 2010, again, the Dream Act came up again for a vote, failed, unfortunately. A lot of very, you know, heavy weight on people's shoulders after, you know, building up a movement after 3 years, and a lot of finger pointing, you know, back and forth as to who was responsible for this. I think the politics at the time kind of called for a more radical action. And I remember that I was, you know, essentially called to help drive attention to a small sit-in that was happening in the offices of then Senator John McCain from Arizona, who, you know, said that he supported the DREAM Act and Dreamers and beyond, but like he couldn't vote on it on principle or whatever his excuse was at the time. And a group of five young people essentially staged a sit-in at his office and said, you know, we're going to sit in here until the senator commits, you know, to vote for the DREAM Act. And if, you know, he won't, then he'll have to arrest us and then he'll have to deport us. And then the people will really see that he doesn't support Dreamers. And, you know, it was one of those moments where I couldn't be in Arizona myself. SB 1070 and a lot of the tensions that have flared up in immigration at the time were in broad display. And, you know, it was up to me to essentially figure out a way to maneuver, you know, what we were posting online and when, how we were controlling media requests that were pouring in via email and social, how could we stream live this so that other people had access to this. And again, very and I say this like in quotation marks, very, you know, run of the mill type of thing today, right? Like you have Facebook Live, you have Instagram Live, you have all these applications. But in 2010, when they say like, how can we streamline this? And you have this phone, you have to essentially come up with a strategy and you have to come up with a solution, especially if you're in a low budget situation and you have to get crafty. And that's essentially where I plugged in a lot of the time in some of the messaging and how essentially to break through the internet landscape using, for those of you who you know, lean on academia or who, you know, who may write op-eds, you know, writing for the internet, you know, it's much more different than, you know, presenting a formal paper. So that was essentially where I got a lot of my chops at this job in very rapid response scenarios. Those five people that staged the sit-in were not deported, but it ignited a movement that put pressure on the Obama administration that essentially yielded the DACA program in 2012. And ever since then, you know, it's been a fight to kind of protect this program and fight for additional layers of protection for the immigrant rights community. You know, from 2007, where we started, to 2012, you know, 5 years had gone by, the iPhone became mainstream, BlackBerry was gone, Facebook was more, you know, built out with new features and beyond. Instagram was a thing, and Twitter was more of an adoptable, you know, interfaceable platform that it was in years past. And as the internet changes, it's up to me to also educate people on, you know, new features, new changes, but also determine how do those new changes and features can be folded and implemented into our work. There's never like a ceiling. I think it's an ever evolving, you know, just as many people are learning how to navigate Zoom, I'm often figuring out ways in which we can, you know, have another inch of the internet, you know, dedicated for immigrant rights, and how can people essentially use it and engage with it. Some of it's silly, like those stickers and GIFs that you may see pop up in certain platforms. Others are more serious, like, you know, how essentially do we host, you know, prolonged programs about immigration on the web, and how do we keep the audience engaged? You know, what is essentially the messaging that goes before, you know, how many emails do we have to send out? Very, you know, marketing type of like questions, but there's always that political angle for an issue that a lot of people may not always understand or may deem too polarizing or divisive or so on and so forth. And it's up to me to kind of blend both of those two things together. Before I go into the next slide, I just wanted to kind of give like a quick example of what I mean by all this. And I should have added a clip from the newspaper, but I'll just summarize it here. In 2015, I finished my graduate degree from Florida State University. And what ended up happening was that I got a job at a small nonprofit in DC. I was working remotely at the time. And when the president, then candidate, essentially launched his campaign by insulting a significant chunk of the immigrant population, I immediately discovered that Saturday Night Live, you know, one of the biggest, you know, programs and broadcasts here in the United States, was going to offer him the opportunity to host the show. You know, fairly new, and I mean, like, I must have been like 3-4 weeks into the job, I told my boss, like, we can't let this happen. Like, this is insane, not just because it's one of the most viewed programs, you know, when it comes down to like, you know, traditional American audiences, but also like, you can't satirize this. Like, you can't make this man, you know, a caricature of what he really is. You know, this is dangerous. And after some back and forth, I decided to launch a campaign. So I wrote up a petition, you know, went to bed. The next day, it had like 90,000 signatures from people saying, like, you're right, Donald Trump cannot host Saturday Night Live. And, you know, what I had done there was essentially not just written a petition and threw it up online, is that I recognized kind of like this, the constellation of things that were happening. You know, a very dangerous man was being given the opportunity to make fun of his own platform and try to normalize it. There was a lot of outrage building, you know, from different segments of the population, but nobody was doing anything about it. So I just saw that opportunity myself and said, you know, if no one's going to do it, I'm going to do it. So with 90,000 petitions under my belt, I, you know, reached out to other organizations and developed a small online coalition from Voto Latino, change.org and beyond. And between all of us, we had 500,000 petition signatures to try to get Donald Trump off Saturday Night Live. I flew to New York City the day of the program, and I, you know, I don't know what I was expecting. I thought like maybe a reporter was going to show up and ask me what I was doing with this cardboard box that had like 500,000 petition signatures to get Donald Trump off Saturday Night Live. And what ended up happening was that a giant crowd, you know, was there with me, showed up, you know, as a part of a local rally, and people, you know, wanted to lend their voice and their support. You know, over 24 hours, I was pulled in all kinds of media interviews. And while the president ended up going on the show, it made a very big dent in the program. That particular episode flopped. Some cast members expressed regret of being on it. And, you know, we, you know, accomplished part of our goal, which was to essentially tell the you know, the media industry that we were going to stand by. We weren't going to stand by this, you know, free pass that they were giving this man at the time. I say this story namely for, you know, illustration of how just, you know, understanding the landscape that we live in, but also essentially using digital tools that are easily available to us, you know, can essentially have a profound impact on something as simple as somebody being on a TV show. This is more on the immigration side. You know, the reason why we are where we are in the particular movement is because there hasn't been conclusive immigration reform, and polarization continues to essentially be the driving force behind a lot of the things that we see. When we talk about immigration, there's always, you know, a debate pending, whether it's from one person or from bad actors on the internet. For those of you who, you know, may have questions about, like, what do I do when somebody says something mean on my Facebook page, or, you know, sends me a mean text message, you know, the best practice always tells us to ignore it. You know, don't give those people legitimacy by engaging with them, but more often than not, you know, don't waste your time trying to change someone's mind, because in the internet, no one really wins, because there's always, you know, things that are left unsaid behind the keyboard that you may not be aware about. And it's that type of attitude that you have to essentially develop in order to fully understand, you know, the dynamics of, like, interpersonal relationships in real life versus, you know, relationships that may form, partnerships that may form, collaborations that may form across two different sets of screen. I think I'm gonna just hop over here onto the next one. And essentially, you know, kind of illustrate a little bit about, like, where do we go from here? I'm rushing a little bit because I want to give some time to questions, and I know I'm pressing into the realm of, like, I'm maybe running out of time, and I want to make sure that the program keeps going.
You have about 15 minutes.
Perfect. So I wanted to make sure that people understood a couple of things. This slide, a portion of this presentation, was made before the pandemic. If you told me when I built this program, you know, where do we go from here? And I left some of these slides in here purposefully because, you know, we don't have a lot of answers. You know, we're planning for a variety of different scenarios. We're in an election year. We're still in the midst of that pandemic. Although the DACA program won at the Supreme Court, and, you know, we've continuously seen victories at the Supreme Court in a variety of different issues that impact our community, the future still remains uncertain. You know, there is no semblance of when life will return to pre-pandemic days that I personally can see. You know, we still don't understand, you know, what a vaccine, you know, would do or look like, and, you know, who would take it and not take it. And in the midst of all this, right, we still have the traditional tools that are given to us through the internet in terms of programs like these, Zoom, Google Docs, which I'm a very big fan of, you know, social media and beyond. And what has happened in the course of the past 6 months is that people have had to adjust. You know, we've always heard this ad nauseum. It's like, you know, these are unprecedented times. People have had to adjust. People were going to do, you know, we as Juana said, we were supposed to be in San Antonio. And now we're doing this over Zoom in the comfort of our homes or our designated offices, probably isolated. And what has happened is that in the past 6 months, people have had to become, you know, voracious and fierce adopters of the internet, because that's the way that, you know, we're functioning as a society right now. And while it is, you know, extremely troubling, given the amount of uncertainty that we continue to experience and, you know, some of the challenges that we continue to see on a regular basis, it's also an opportunity to learn new things, which is why, you know, I try, like, right now, I'm literally going into some of the more, I don't want to say less streamlined corners of the internet, but I'm going into other places to kind of figure out how I can also make a mark there, or test new messaging, or engage new people. because I have time. And now that has also become more of a fundamental part of my job, because we're not allowed to have rallies in front of the Supreme Court. And if we do, it's a severe health risk, are we being responsible for doing all that? Same thing with lobbying Congress. You know, how is that going to look, you know, whenever a piece of policy comes up in the next couple of years? Or for those of you who may be involved in state legislatures, you know, how is that going to look? You know, before it used to be that you just walked into the state capitol and said, hey, you, stop doing that, or hey, you, support this. And now that may not be the case for, you know, the upcoming legislative sessions. If Florida is in the spring, I have no idea, that, and that's my home state. You know, I don't know what that's going to look like. And it's incumbent on all of us, right, to start asking these questions, right? Like, how can I see this commission meeting through the web? Is there a live streaming? If there's not, then why? You know, how can I engage in these conversations online? You know, that make an impact, not just, you know, write a rant on a comment on a newspaper article that I read. And it's gonna take some time. I say this with a sense of cynicism and optimism at the same time, which, you know, for me kind of going hand in hand given the times that we live in. But at the same time, I think it's extremely, despite the unknown factors that I just outlined, I think it's extremely accelerating for me, because that means that a lot of the learning curves are trying to be, people are trying to go over them in order to adopt more technology and streamline some of their processes. And even if they are not like digital advocates, digital strategists, or, you know, they don't use the internet, you know, the way that I use it, it does do one thing. It lowers the barrier of entry for that person to get plugged in into bigger things, which means that that person is now possibly a target of mine in the realm of me eventually reaching out to them. It's like, hey, have you ever used Zoom? Or hey, have you ever been on Twitter? Or hey, have you ever done a Facebook Live? And it's kind of hard to predict or see how much longer it would have taken had we not had, you know, this series of events transposed with the past number of months. So I don't want to say that this is a good thing, because obviously the death toll continues to rise in this country. Misinformation continues to be pumped out through the same mediums that I'm advocating for. And there's still a lot of work to do. But the truth of the matter is that moving forward, a lot of us are going to have to essentially do some really deep soul searching in terms of like how we consume information, how do we share and propagate information. And it's going to be incumbent on people like myself to make sure that the way that we engage, you know, everyday people through the web is not just responsible, but it's also grounded on reality that can be immediately, you know, either fact checked or, can be proven without people having to essentially suffer at the hands of false and misleading information and claims. So again, you know, I am undocumented. I'm kind of ending the presentation with on a more real note here. These are things that I currently experience, you know, fear, anxiety, and uncertainty. These are no longer exclusive to me. I think a lot of people, given the set of circumstances, you know, can essentially, aspects in their different lives, you know, also lead them to carry this. But at least for me, you know, with just 5 weeks until the election, these things become a little bit heavier, because given the horrors that we've seen over the past 4 years, it's become clear to me that we need to essentially act and become even more engaged over the next number of years, if we are to not just quote unquote rebuild institutions and rebuild aspects of our democracy that have been casted into doubt. But it's also about protecting, you know, the most vulnerable populations that this administration has set on to attack at all costs. So for me, some of these things have become heavier, but I continue to do the work that I do, namely for two things. One, this is like the 15th year that I've run this type of operation. So it's already kind of like ingrained in my DNA. Two, I love what I do. But three, also, I find that I have a sense of responsibility to carry some of these pieces in here, and to make sure that people understand that, you know, their power lies in a variety of different places. I may not be able to vote, for example. I may be vulnerable to deportation if the DACA program goes away, but I am sure as hell not going to let any of that, you know, stop me from, you know, telling my story, educating other people about how to use the internet for good, and, you know, making sure that people understand that, you know, immigrants are, you know, way more than just, you know, their immigration status. They're actual human beings with families and lives. So wanted to make sure that I put that in there.
So we have time for a few questions then, or you're going to do
Perfect.
No, go
ahead.
Yeah.
So here's the last slide here. I rushed through this. I rushed through this for two reasons. One, I say that namely because my employer has a much robust, you know, set of trainings that go along, and sometimes, you know, it goes on for 2 to 3 days depending on, you know, that kind of stuff, and the resources that are allocated for that. So this is kind of like a first glance as to, you know, how I use the internet and how essentially it worked out for me. But there are, you know, a variety of different techniques and a variety of different things. So, you know, feel free to check in with me, or feel free to, you know, reach out to me. I'm happy to always be of a resource to people. You know, a lot of people right now are experiencing some hardships. You know, some people are able to donate, some people are not able to donate. I encourage you to become familiar with local organizations. Even though I work on a national facing issue, and I'm based out of Washington, D.C., I'm also a firm believer that one of the best ways to bring about change is within the local community, namely because anything that happens to the local community can probably have 10, 20, 30, 40, 50% more of a direct impact. That's something that Congress may do in the long or short term, especially at the state level. I talked about the New York driver's license bill that we passed last year. Thousands and thousands of people will have their lives transformed overnight just over that bill. And it's more than I can say that anything has happened in Congress over the past number of years. And with that same pitch, you know, volunteer. Volunteer your time. If you're able to, if you're not able to, you know, donate, use those interchangeably. And if you can't, you know, there's always something out there that you can do, even if it takes a couple minutes of your time. And, you know, I'm happy to walk through some of those opportunities with you. So again, you know, thank you for your time, and thank you, Juana, for the space.
I might add, Juan, that most of our people are leaders or have organizations. So instead of just an individual strategy, this is an opportunity to look at how, and many of us do work in immigration already, but this is an opportunity for them to bring it to their organization and make immigration, you know, one of the goals that they have to work on, and that it is a civil rights issue for all of us now. And one of the things about Latino leaders is that, you know, we care about our people. So immigration is now one of our top agendas. So we can take a couple of questions, maybe just two. Jackie, do we have?
Yes, we do. And for anyone listening on interpretation, I just want to apologize. We're trying a different mic, so please hold on. And Juan, for your questions, we have a few. We also have a quick comment. Love the SNL story and campaign. Thank you.
just Google Juan Escalante in SNL. I think I peaked too early at that job, because that was like within a couple of like months of my hiring, and then the executive director was like, all right, can you do that every week? And I'm like, no. Like, it was such an incredible experience, but at the same time, it's one of the very rare, you know, moments in life where you kind of like really make something out of like what seemingly was just some disgruntled people on the internet, and ended up being a gigantic movement. So I'm very proud of that.
So I'm not sure. Can you see my screen?
I can, yes.
All right, so I'll let you do the top one. What is the solution to DACA? Despite party affiliation, what are the steps to resolve this problem? Because we cannot count on our leaders at the state, federal, Congress to make any progress. Until Congress grows up and quits acting like children, what's the solution?
You know, I wish there was one. Unfortunately, there's going to be a lot of very tough choices in here over the next couple of years. And I say all this, namely, without my organizational hat on, but namely, you know, as someone who has seen this issue come and go. We need federal legislation. Like, there just really isn't another way around it. You know, we went through the Supreme Court, we won. This administration wants to, you know, essentially cast doubt on, you know, on our ruling and wants to play by their own rules. Even if this administration was on the way out and we got a new one in and they restored the DACA program to its full, strength from the get-go, there's no telling that another administration couldn't come in and undo it again. And rather than putting people's lives in this, you know, prolonged ping pong match where they have to essentially always fear that their status may or may not come to an end, the best way for us is to move forward with federal legislation and figure out a way to make that a reality. At the same time, I'm not unaware that, you know, saying that is way easier than is than it, you know, it sounds way easier than it actually is in real life. You know, for those of us who worked on immigration, who have seen the debate, you know, we know that it takes years for, you know, certain policy windows to open. You know, that's why for me, and I mentioned this, you know, during the closing, is that, you know, state policy continues to be one of the biggest avenues for change. So, you know, it's definitely not a replacement for the DACA program, a federal initiative that is essentially carried out through the Department of Homeland Security. But at the same time, I'm a firm believer that in states where you have driver's licenses for undocumented immigrants, institution for Dreamers, and some of these programs, right, it still has transformational impact on the lives of individuals. Given everything that has happened, you know, in the past 4 years and, you know, family separations and some of the horrors coming out of private detention facilities in the past couple of weeks, it's become even more increasingly clear to me that we need to essentially make some very, very aggressive choices when it comes down to, you know, prioritization of the next legislative agenda from the next administration, so that people no longer have to feel like they have to live in fear of deportation, but also that they don't continue to be discriminated or abused at the hands of the systems that are currently in place.
Well, Juan, I want to thank you for being with us. And you are our second millennial presenter. We really believe not only in intergenerational leadership, but really helping our young people become the leaders they can be. We want to thank you for your work in DACA. We want to congratulate you for your success and also for showing the contributions that DACA DACA members, what do you call it, DACA people, make to our country and to our community. So muchas gracias, vaya con Dios, and we will see you on the web until we meet in person.
Thank you so much.
All right, for those of you that were with us yesterday, the next speaker is Dr. Patricia Gonzalez, and if you have a chance, please go and get a candle, because we're going to light a candle to remember and honor our ancestors. So if you can do that, that would be great. We now have a little bit of a break, and it's a salsa break. And some of you will be able to get into this, and some of you will say, wow, this is a good time to get another cup of coffee. But I'm gonna tell you, it's going to be a lot of fun. So let me get the words up. Okay, slideshow from beginning. Uh-oh, I did made a mistake. End show, slideshow. So how am I doing as an elder on the internet and using Zoom? It's a new thing for us, and it was so great to have Juan, because for that generation, this is like you know, my daughter who's a millennial, this is just part of her, she's just wired onto these computers and so forth. So we're going to use Mark Anthony's song, and I'm going to actually take it down for a minute so that I can tell you what we're going to do. So let's see here, end show, okay. All right. So you're going to, just don't pay attention to this for a minute, because I'm going to come on and show you how to do, most of you know this, how to do the basic salsa step. And then we're going to put on Mark Anthony, one of our dear and wonderful leaders in our community, who tells us to live life, to have passion, to remember, to have joy. And, you know, Latinos are really bringing that passion and joy to America. So the first thing we're gonna do is the basic salsa step. As all of you know, it's forward, one, one, two, three, back, one, two, three, forward, one, two, three, back, one, two, three. We'll do that four times, and then side, one, two, three, side, one, two, three, side, one, two, three, side, one, two, three. And then we'll do back, one, two, three, back, one, two, three. We'll do each of these four times, and we will create this incredible dancing energy across all of these states and places that we're all from. So please join me. I will. Well, here's a problem. You can't see me if I put up the words. So I'll just be telling you the moves. Unfortunately, you won't be able to see. Okay, so here we go.
Empieza a soñar, a reír.
Tell you all is a little bit about this song and why it's so important. So, and then I'll let you take a little break and get your candle and get ready for a fabulous presentation. So this is a song that is very traditional for our culture, even though it's new. Yesterday we sang Cerrito Lindo. It's the same message. It's the same message that Celia Cruz gave us when she said, La vida es un carnaval. You don't have to cry. And what I think is so important about this is that Latinos are optimistic. In fact, the New York Times did a study about Latino optimism. And I just want to tell you that 75% of Latinos believe their opportunity to succeed is better than their parents. That's only 56% for non-Latinos. 64% of Latinos believe their life would be better for their children. And this jumped to 83% for immigrants. Latino immigrants like Juan, like me, like all of us, who believed our lives would get better, but only 39% for Anglos. And so one of the principles of Latino leadership is to gozar la vida, you know, to be able to have that joy, that passion, that ability to celebrate together, because we cannot even tell the people that follow us or those of us who have worked in communities for so many years, Juan already at his young age, 13 years of activism, we can't even tell them that we will reach our goals in this lifetime. But what we can tell them is that we will leave them a legacy and that we will make life better for them in the future. And that's one thing that makes Latino leadership so powerful. And so now we get an opportunity to be with someone who's going to help us connect to that past, to that ancestry, because Latinos also believe, you know, that our ancestors walk with us. And I wanted to show you just a quick slide on this. Connect to the power of our ancestry. I believe that Dia de los Muertos will be another gift, this connection to our ancestors, that Latinos will give to America. The idea that, you know, we are a continuation, a legacy that is moving forward. So that's a picture of my Dia de los Muertos altar and me ready for Dia de los Muertos, which is coming up. So let's welcome Patricia Gonzalez. I do want to tell you a little bit about her. Because I have